Bismillah, alhamdulillah, salatu wasalam ala rasulullah. This is part 8 of the biography of Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wasallam. We call it the Seerah in Arabic, from the book The Sealed Nectar, Ar-Rahiq al-Makhtum. We talked in the last course, I was on shore and I talked on the night ascension, the blessed night ascension of Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wasallam, Al-Isra wal-Mi'raj. And you can go back to it inshallah. So I go directly to the next events that happened in Mecca. Prophet Muhammad gave pledges to the Sahaba that came from Medina to give pledge to the Prophet Muhammad. In the first pledge, we mentioned how Prophet Muhammad started to meet the Sahaba. He met first of all five of the Sahaba, and these five came back in the first pledge. It's called Bay'at al-Aqab al-Ula, allegiance to the Prophet Muhammad. Five from those came back in the next year of Hajj. They were Mu'ad ibn al-Harith, Dhikwan ibn al-Qais, Ubada ibn al-Samit, Yazid ibn Tha'lab al-Abbas, ibn Ubada Abu al-Haytham, wa Uwaym ibn Sa'ida. They came back to give pledge to Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam that they will give him triumph insha'Allah. After that, Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam sent to the Medina Mus'ab ibn Umair. So Mus'ab ibn Umair is the first ambassador in Islam. He sent him to Medina, and he started to meet the leaders of Medina, the elite from amongst them. He met Sa'd ibn Mu'adh and Usayd ibn Hudhair. He went as a guest to As'ad. Remember As'ad ibn Zarar, who came first to meet the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. And he started to talk with them. They said, we will do such and such to you if you don't leave this. They threatened him, but he told them, first of all, listen to us. And if you don't like what we say, then you can, we will cease, you know, making da'wah. But then they liked the Quran, they liked how the message is clear in Islam and so on, and they became Muslim. People in each and every house in Medina, people becoming Muslim, and the Prophet Muhammad is very happy. And Mus'ab ibn Umair, remember this name, Mus'ab ibn Umair gives glad tidings to Prophet Muhammad afterwards that each and every house in Medina now, alhamdulillah, there is a Muslim in Medina. Why? I told you why before, because the Jews made it easy for the Muslims in Medina to become Muslim, because they were saying that this is the era when a prophet will come from amongst the Jews. They knew he's an Arab, but they were lying, and we will fight you. And they were, you know, already waiting for a prophet to come from amongst the Arabs. Yet in Bay'at al-Aqaba Thaniya, the second allegiance given by the Sahaba, by the Mushrikeen, that they were back then Mushrikeen, they were 72 men. From amongst the women were Nusayba and Asma bint Amr. So two women and 73 men gave pledge to the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. How was that? Let's know inshallah how was that. First of all, they made agreement to meet at night in the 10th year of the Nubuwa, the prophethood. They met secretly in one of the mountains of Mecca, but the devil, Shaitan, screamed on Quraysh and said they are doing such and such, and suddenly, you know, Quraysh discovered that they were giving pledge to each other, and it was called the second allegiance given by the Sahaba to give triumph to Prophet Muhammad. But fortunately, and until they finished, then the devil discovered this and screamed and shouted to Quraysh that they are, you know, they are preparing to make war against you and so on. Quraysh took one of them to give the secrets to them. He refused. He was saved by someone. He said, you will go to Medina on their trade road to Syria, and they will not let you go. So they let him. And before the pledge was given, Al-Abbas, the uncle of Prophet Muhammad, who wasn't even Muslim back then, he said, do you know, Jabir too said this. He said, do you feel the responsibility of what you are going to do? He said, yes, we feel the responsibility, and we'll give him triumph, and we'll do war and defend the Prophet like we defend ourselves and our blood and our children. And Prophet was happy with that. The Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam wrote down the treaty terms that, hey guys, I mean, you will give me triumph from amongst the Khazraj, the biggest town in Medina. As'ad ibn Zurara, Sa'd ibn Rabi, Abdullah ibn Rawaha, Rafi ibn Malik, Al-Bara ibn Ma'rur, Abdullah ibn Amr ibn Haram, Ubada ibn Samit, Sa'd ibn Ubada, Al-Mundir ibn Amr, and from the Aus, Usayd ibn Hudayr, Sa'd ibn Khathiyama, Rifa' ibn Abdullah, and they were elected as the leaders of each tribe, these Sahaba, mashallah. Sahaba now are ordered by the Prophet Muhammad to make hijrah to Medina from, because of much torturing in Mecca, etc. They started to emigrate to Medina, but the mushrikeen tortured them. and do not let them go. Anyone who dares to go to Medina will be tortured, will be enchained, and given as an example of humiliation of to the other Sahabas. But the Sahaba knew that if they do immigration, they will leave their money and their children and maybe their lots and their houses behind them. But even though they made hijrah, look at what the Sahaba endured to bring us this Islam. We find it as easy as water, but they endured. They lost their money for the Islam. Even they knew that they will go to Medina, they will have nothing. But at the same time, they sacrificed all what they had for Islam. For Islam to reach you. So what have you done for Islam? If the Sahaba have endured all this, left all their wealth and anything behind them, and sacrificed, what have you done to Islam? To the extent when Abu Salama immigrated to the Medina, his wife was caught by his father-in-law and taken by the family of Abu Salama from one hand and by her family from one hand until they did this to his son until they removed his hand because of too much pulling. And then she would go to the son outside and scream and shout and cry and weep and tear. Until one of her family, you know, pity her and send her with a Sahabi to Medina. Sorry, he never talked to her. Look at the manners of the Arabs back then. Look at the manners, subhanAllah. Accompanying a woman from Mecca to Medina to reach her husband in Medina, never talked to her a word. Another Sahabi was chased to go back to Mecca after he immigrated. He's Abu Suhaib. Allah, Prophet Muhammad said, he wins. This is a successful trade that Abu Suhaib Rumi did. They said, you will not go from here until, you know, you came to us via vagabond and now you go back to, you immigrate with all our money that you traded here. He said, my money is in such and such place. Go, you find it there. Just leave me, go follow the Prophet. And he knew he was truthful. They never betray the Arabs. These are the Arabs back then, subhanAllah. They went, they find his treasure, they take it and they let him go. Allahu Akbar. Another incident narrated by Ibn Hisham that they lied to one of the Sahabi Al-Ayyash who immigrated to Medina. Abu Jahl sent after him someone that your mom is crying, you know, go back to her. But when he was in the middle of the way, they enchained him and set him as an example for anyone to want to immigrate to Medina. They were lying. Umar ibn Khattab said to him, do not go back, they are lying, but he didn't believe in him. Quraysh made a conference in Dar al-Nadwa in their conference house or parliament of Quraysh and said, now the biggest dream, if you want to fight Islam, is kill the Prophet. And they gave billions for anyone to fetch the Prophet alive or dead. People started to look everywhere. They knew that the head of Muslims is the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. The conference was attended by Abu Jahl, Jubair ibn Mut'im, Shayba wa Utba ibn Rabi'a, Abu Sufyan ibn Harb, Al-Harith ibn Amir, each one from their tribe, Al-Bukhtur ibn Hisham, Hakim ibn Hizam, Nabih wa Munabbih, Umayya ibn Khalif. They got together and they said, now Prophet is wanted. Anyone to fetch him dead or alive is gonna have a bonus, the biggest bonus ever. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says in Quran, وَإِذْ يَمْكُرُ بِكَ الَّذِينَ كَفَرُوا لِيُثْبِتُوكَ أَوْ يَقْتُلُوكَ أَوْ يُخْرِجُوكَ وَيَمْكُرُونَ وَيَمْكُرُ اللَّهُ وَاللَّهُ خَيْرُ الْمَاكِرِينَ. They plot, but Allah plots against them. Allah is the best of those, is the best of whom plots against the plotters. This is why Allah only in this case only, it's do not take it out of context. Allah will plot against you if you plot against Allah and the believers. Will deceive you if you want to deceive the believers. This is the only time Allah will deceive you. Allah is not a deceiver, is not a plotter. But if you want to play God, you are gonna be deceived by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. During their conference, everyone spoke, we will enchain him, we will exile him. But Satan talked and said that Abu Jahl is right, you just kill him. So Prophet Muhammad felt this danger of their plot against him to kill him. And he went to Abu Bakr in a time that he never go to Abu Bakr at noon. He said, oh Abu Bakr, it's the time of Hijrah. And Abu Bakr was very happy because he knew that he will accompany the best man ever. And in the best trip ever, they will go to Medina for immigration. All the Sahaba have gone, except few that hide their Islam, and Prophet Muhammad and Abu Bakr are now wanted They will go to the cave of Thawr and Abu Bakr. Now they go to each and every place. They go to the south instead, like Mecca in the south and Medina in the north, to the way of Syria. But Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam was wise and he went south, like going back to Abyssinia, to the Red Sea, and then made a curve. They will never think that he's there. Amir ibn Fahira going after Abdullah ibn Abu Bakr, who was taking food for them, some 15 or 30 kilometers away from Mecca. And Amir ibn Fahira following them with his sheep. He was a shepherd until they were ready to emigrate, until the mushrikeen came to the cave and looked, but they didn't see anything. Abu Bakr said to the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, if anyone just bends to look, he will see us. Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, what do you think? Two, three with them is Allah. Allah is the third. So the ma'iyya, the togetherness of the Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is with us, not like the people of Moses, the children of Bani Israel. Allah is only with Moses, but Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is with all of us. He's above his throne, but with us with his knowledge and power. They couldn't see, like the incident that happened when Arwa, the wife of Abu Lahab, came with a stone once to hit the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Abu Bakr was sitting here, Prophet near him, she didn't see him. Allah sealed her eyes. And before entering the cave, Abu Bakr made sure that all the holes are covered, and he covered them with stones, etc. Except one hole, he covered it with his phoenix. But the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam was sleeping on his thigh, and something stung him in his phoenix, in his foot, and he couldn't waken the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam because of his love. Ya Allah, look at the love, look at the real love. Not someone you claim you love them and you hurt them day and night with backbiting, etc., with shaming them in public and in private. Come on, I mean, this is not love. Love is obedience. Love is you never hurt those you love until a drop of tears fell on the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, and he woke up. He said, "What's happened?" He said, "Something stung me. Why didn't you wake me up?" He said, "I love you, ya Prophet, and I don't want to get you up." Allahu Akbar. So that is the interpretation of the ayah. وَإِذْ يَمْكُرُ بِكَ الَّذِينَ كَفَرُوا لِيُثْبِتُوكَ أَوْ يَقْتُلُوكَ أَوْ يُخْرِجُوكَ وَيَمْكُرُونَ وَيَمْكُرُ اللَّهُ وَاللَّهُ خَيْرُ الْمَاكِرِينَ. Allah is the best of plotters if you want to plot against God. And in the place of Prophet Muhammad Ali slept in the place of Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, sleeping relaxed. And they said, "How did you pass that night?" He said, "The best night." Prophet Muhammad let him behind him to give the savings to Quraysh. He was the bank of Quraysh. They give him savings at night. By day, they fight him. And they were, stalking. Where is the Prophet? They never go out, so he's at home. They make sure he's at home. And Prophet Muhammad came out and took, he gripped sand and threw in their eyes. And he said, "Shahat al-uyun." And he recited, وَجَعَلْنَا مِن بَيْنِ أَيْدِيهِمْ سَدًّا وَمِنْ خَلْفِهِمْ سَدًّا فَأَغْشَيْنَاهُمْ فَهُمْ لَا يُبْصِرُونَ. He recited the ayats. We made before them and behind them a barrier, and we covered their eyes, we sealed their eyes, and they cannot see. Allah, Prophet Muhammad has reciting this ayah and passing, amongst them, and they didn't see them. He gave them trunk liver. They died, they slept and they never. In the morning, someone came, hit them, wake up, what's happening? Why all this dust on you? He said, he left, he escaped. He threw dust on their heads as humiliation for them, that you can never, win or be triumphant. It's a humiliation to them, and he left from amongst their eyes. This is the miracle, trust Allah. Subhanallah. And he left. When he was on his way, he saw many incidents, like the woman who depicted him, how he is. She described him, his eyes, his nose, his everything. And in the morning, they heard a jinn, describing this scene. In Mecca, people knew that he's about to reach Medina, because he reached the house of Ummu Ma'bad, and the husband of Ummu Ma'bad, he was amazed. How come your house there is milk, and our sheep there is no milk yet in our sheep? But Alhamdulillah, this barakah. She said, a man passed by me He said, that's the Prophet, I want to follow him and believe in him. And he also was attacked back by Abdullah ibn Urayqit. The legs of his horse sank in the sand for three times. And then he said, okay, I believe in you, just, you know, set me free. Prophet Muhammad says, never say this to anyone where I am. And he fulfilled, mashallah, he promised. He saw a miracle that happened to him. Prophet never, you know, looking back. But Abu Bakr looking back, you know, the man was, you know, approaching them to hit or something, but Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala saved the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. On his way to the Medina, he met someone who's named Abu Burayda. Abu Burayda wanted the bonus from Quraysh, but when he saw the Prophet, handsome he is, and he's Sahabi, and the Quran he talks, he believed, and 70 from amongst his people become Muslim. This is Islam. You come to fight Islam, Islam will enter your heart. Also, another incident happened in Medina. They were walking towards Medina, and a man asks, where are you from? Abu Bakr or Prophet Muhammad has some spokesperson. He said, we are from water. He means we are created out of water. But there is a place in Medina, near Medina, called water. They said, okay, then you are from such and such place. You go. So it's halal in Islam to lie to the enemies. But better use this. I mean, better transfer the meaning to something else. This is exactly what Abraham said. He said, Sarah is my sister, and he let him. So this is the only time where you are allowed to lie in Islam, to lie to the enemies, to lie to your wife, you know, to breed compassion between you and her. You say, I love you very much, even you hate her. And to lie, to reconcile between two people. Only in Islam. There are no white lies, no April lies, nothing. Now Prophet Muhammad is about to reach Medina. He left behind him Ali. Why? To distribute the savings that the Quraysh left for Prophet Muhammad to hide, to keep. And he gave them back their savings, and he rushed after the Prophet Muhammad. This is part 8 of the seerah of Prophet Muhammad, the first allegiance, the second allegiance, and the hijrah. How tough was the hijrah, and how Prophet Muhammad endured all these hundreds of kilometers to go to Medina to escape from the torture of Mecca, to in order to build a new state, a new strong Islamic first state ever. He remained in Mecca for 13 years only to demand them to say one word, La ilaha illallah, 7 words, you know, they will be the kings and they will rule the world with it, but they refused. So he go to Medina now, and Mecca now will feel the danger that is in Medina against them. They consider this as danger, you know, the strength of Muslims. Muslims want only to their welfare and only reconciliation. If they don't want war, just let them spread Islam, but they will not let them. And we shall know this, inshallah, in part 9. Jazakumullah khair. Wassalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh.